the ARC Alliance has been in your community, providing support and services for families and individuals with special needs. From birth through life, the ARC Alliance team of experts and specialists are here to find solutions to your needs.
For years, we felt alone as we take care of our son. The ARC Alliance support team brings compassion and understanding to our family and provides hands-on solutions.
The ARC Alliance, we're here to help you today. For more information, call 610-265-4700 or visit thearcalliance.org.
Good morning and welcome to the ARC Alliance Bridges in the Community. My name is Scott Camilleri. I'm the host today and welcome you to the program. The ARC Alliance, for many of our viewers know, we support and serve individuals with developmental disabilities from birth throughout life, from therapy to support coordination. And this month, the month of March, is a very exciting time for the developmental disability community, as it is Developmental Disability Month, to bring awareness. And as you know, there are many months throughout the year that we highlight issues or causes. October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. February was Black History Month, and this month is Developmental Disability Month. So we are excited about that, and we invite you to participate in raising awareness for the issues and causes for individuals with developmental disabilities and their families. And you don't have to wait and have someone prompt you on. You can start on March 1st. You can start today. By simply becoming a fan of the ARC Alliance Facebook page and share that with your community and your friends. Throughout the month, we'll be posting activities, we'll be posting stories of individuals that you can then take and send out to friends to help us raise awareness for our cause. In addition, you can start today by joining the ARC Alliance 1951 Club, which celebrates over 65 years of supporting and serving individuals and their families. Well, in that celebrating and in that reflective perspective, today we're joined by Jim Conroy. Jim is going to just provide us kind of a historical look, a current, and into the future of state institutions, state centers, but in particular, the Pennhurst Center. Jim, welcome. It's great to have you.
Thank you.
And to start off, why don't you just give us kind of a broad perspective of yourself, your background, and then we'll go from there.
Thank you, Scott. First, I should mention I'm a lifetime member of the ARC, which is one of the most important civil rights movements in America and that people know very little about. So it's a great honor for me to be here right now and to get to tell a story that very few people know about. The story of placing people with developmental disabilities in institutions is a long one. It's a century and a half. And I fell into it, as a friend of mine says, you get into this field in two ways, a relative or pure chance. You know, I received education in physiological psychology at one of the nation's great universities. And when I got out in 1970, I knew nothing about people with disabilities in America because they were so hidden. So by pure chance, I got a job with a degree basically in brain research. I got a job in a brand new area of American social service, which was then called developmental disabilities. That term was brand new in 1970, and the Congress passed a law called the Developmental Disabilities Act, and a consulting firm that I luckily got a job with was studying all over the nation what impact this new terminology would have. The old terminology was mental retardation, and in one day, with a stroke of the pen, the Developmental Disabilities Act brought in people with cerebral palsy, people with epilepsy, and related conditions. Now that includes autism. So developmental disabilities was a new term. And I was the only guy in the company who had taken statistics. So I designed a national sample. We pulled pieces of paper out of a big cardboard box, and everybody in the company went to physically see some people who were receiving supports in developmental disabilities. And I drew Pennhurst, which was then called Pennhurst State School and Hospital. And that really is the beginning of my involvement and my lifetime of involvement in this field. I borrowed my father's blue Chevy and drove up to Spring City, Pennsylvania, where Pennhurst was, and I saw, well, something I can't really explain. You can see an expose of conditions at Pennhurst on our website, which is the Pennhurst Memorial and Preservation Alliance, very easy to find. There was a 1968 expose of conditions there, and it really shocked America at how horribly we were treating American citizens. And so I saw that in 1971 at Pennhurst, and you know that feeling, this was the time of the women's movement, the civil rights movement, the we were just becoming aware of the environmental issues. But instantly I was driven by the thought, we've got to do something about this. There were over 3,000 people in a place that was built for not even half that many people, and there were beds 1 inch apart, and the stories of abuse were rampant. We knew from the expose in 1968 by Bill Baldini that abuse was indeed rampant, and there's no way to avoid that. When you have 3,000 people crammed into a small space and they're isolated from society, things will go wrong. We've learned that again and again in American history, and most recently we had to learn it again at Abu Ghraib. Prisons, mental hospitals, institutions for people with developmental disabilities, nursing homes, all these places that are large, segregated, isolated, things go wrong. And really no one's figured out a way to stop it. What happened here at Pennhurst is so many things that people aren't aware of, that 1968 expose resulted in the ARC of Pennsylvania saying, we can't permit this, we didn't know it was that bad, and they hired a lawyer. And from there, the story really continues. It's largely a legal story of getting rights. It is a civil rights movement that people who had done no harm to anyone were being put away and locked up all over America. There were 293 institutions like Pennhurst when I first started working in this field in 1971. And Pennhurst was not particularly better or worse than any of the others, but it became well known because of that expose. And indeed, there were ample evidence of overcrowding, underfunding, understaffing, abuse of the people to each other, and abuse by staff to the people who lived there, and every kind of abuse you can imagine was going on there. And in particular, many years later, we learned that things went on at night in these institutions that really shaped people's fear for the rest of their lives. Sexual abuse was widespread and the most covered up and hidden. Well, now, years later, we can look back on this and say that's a period of American history that we've gotten through. We learned a tremendous amount from the Pennhurst experience. So, Scott, the ARC deserves credit for bringing this to light and helping end the era of large-scale segregation.
Well, when we were just looking at having this discussion, one of my colleagues has a book that really reflects the history of Pennhurst, and as I was going through it, you could see the kind of the beginning from a pictorial perspective, the beginning of Pennhurst, and over time how it seemed, at least from a pictorial, that it digressed significantly. So starting these centers, it seemed as though from all information provided was a good or a thoughtful idea potentially, but over time has, as you've said, through longitudinal studies and just the perspective, have seen that, hey, we can provide support and services for individuals in a much better way, and they can develop much greater than being institutionalized. And with that kind of perspective, I'm sure you have stories and thoughts on, hey, here were some potentially good things that came out of Pennhurst, out of institutions, and as you were mentioning the overcrowding, there are some things that were tragic in this whole situation. Can you kind of bring some of those to light for us?
It's really a pleasure to be able to talk about it, because this is a tale of much tragedy, but with an essentially happy ending. America has come so far in this field, and so far beyond other countries. So few people know that the idea of institutions in America began in about 1850, roughly, and it was right here. The place called Elwin was the first publicly funded institution in the U.S., depending on which historian you talk to and what month it is. But it really began here. And they grew and grew and grew, but they were intended to be agricultural, self-sufficient communities where the people would learn to grow food and care for animals. They were farms. And people were placed into these far away from downtown Philadelphia. They were placed into them. And from 1850 to about 1900, we just built more and more of them, because the motivation was good. We wanted people to be safe and released from the stress of pressures of society and work and possibly the abuse of other people in their schools. We feared that a lot. But from that time, it really was the idea of segregation dominated. By about 1880, though, the idea of social Darwinism cropped up. That is, survival of the fittest in the human species. And every part of American culture ran toward the idea of eugenics, which means good birth, that we could breed faults out of our species with selective breeding. So immediately we decided, okay, people with developmental disabilities, at that time called mental deficiency or mental retardation, okay, they can't breed. So we have to segregate the sexes, and that happened in all of our institutions in America. Then we thought, well, we'd better be very sure they can't breed, so we started sterilizing people without their consent. It was just a normal part of treatment. And then the American Eugenics Society sprang up and became a powerful force in the world. Woodrow Wilson, Teddy Roosevelt, they all subscribed to this theory that we could improve the species by not letting the defective folks reproduce. And that led to sterilization, isolation, congregation, segregation. And in the 30s, all of those thoughts came home to roost when the Nazis took that very idea of eugenics and just took it one step further. Why wait for sterilization to have its effect when we could just murder the people that we don't like? And that was really an American and British idea of eugenics taken to its extreme in World War II and the attempted extermination of first children with disabilities in German society by doctors, lethal injections. Very few people know about that. And then the Roma, the Gypsies, and then the Jews, and so on and so forth. It was an ideology gone wild, and we have learned so much from that experience that I dare to hope that the human species will never repeat it again. At Pennhurst, though, we had about 3,500 people in 1970, and very few people have ever heard the story of how we got kids with disabilities into public schools. And it began right here. When the ARC of Pennsylvania hired an attorney, this young attorney, fresh out of Yale Law School, was convinced that we didn't have the right case law to sue Pennhurst to fix it up. But almost everybody who went to Pennhurst got in because they were reaching adolescents and they were harder to support at home. And all people like me, doctors and people with PhDs, we all told parents, Oh, the right thing to do is put your son or daughter at Pennhurst. They'll be safe, they'll be cared for, three meals a day, never have to worry again. And so we did that. But this attorney, whose name was Thomas Gilhool, one of the most famous disability attorneys in the world, advised the ARC of Pennsylvania that, look, we don't have the case law to force the state to make Pennhurst decent, but we could close the front door by allowing all these kids in Pennsylvania with significant disabilities to go to public school. And when I went to public school, I didn't see any kids like this because they weren't allowed. We wouldn't let them in the public school, so mom and dad, one of them had to stay home 24/7. They couldn't have two jobs in that family, and they might have had three other kids. So the idea of placing their son or daughter at Pennhurst was a welcome relief in those days, and it's all we knew how to do. And we thought we were doing a good thing, and I think, as I said, in the 1850s, the spirit was good. We meant to do the best we possibly could, and for 100 years, that was the best we knew how to do. Now we've learned that preventing children from going into a place like that will help them for life. They will be more competent, more capable, more social, and they will have a better quality of life in every way. We know that now. We did not know that then, and it took a long time to prove it. So Pennhurst then was the source, in 1971, of the Pennsylvania Right to Education. And that is the first time in America that kids, regardless of disability, were allowed to go to public school. And it started here, it started because of Pennhurst, and now everybody watching this program, you have sons and daughters, or brothers and sisters, or friends, neighbors, they all go to school now, and there's children with disabilities in all those schools. And my son and my daughter went through school with kids with disabilities, and their attitude is so unlike mine. Their attitude is, yeah, they're different, so what? And my attitude was, they look strange, I'm scared of them. And we had a lot to learn. And nothing helps people to get along with each other like integration.
Right, and that part of, you know, having a month where we're looking at awareness certainly is that kind of moving it forward. Your experience with your son is very similar to my own, where it wasn't till almost his graduation and my involvement with the ARC and knowing families who have children with disabilities and kind of those worlds coming together, and my son's one of his friends that he would talk about at the lunch table, you know, quote unquote, had a disability, but it wasn't the thing that was presented, it was the person that was presented. And that person-centric perspective is so important. But as we look at Pennhurst, can you bring us to its closing and kind of where we are today, maybe even looking in these last few minutes together into the future, knowing that although Pennhurst and several of the centers in the Southeast are no longer, but in fact, we still have five centers in Pennsylvania.
True. Pennhurst went on after the right to education in 1971. Then the next step was to file suit to improve conditions at Pennhurst. But that lawsuit went to federal court, was joined by the United States Department of Justice suing Pennsylvania to make decent conditions at Pennhurst. But it quickly transformed into a case to actually close Pennhurst, to let people move into regular homes, regular communities, right alongside the rest of us. And in those days, this was such a brand new idea, we did not know if it would be a good or bad thing. So having been trained in the sciences, I determined that we had to follow these people if they really were going to go out of Pennhurst and find out if they were okay. And that is called a longitudinal study. And it was done out of Temple University, and it lasted, 5 years, but then it transformed into a monitoring system. So I had the honor and the pleasure of tracking people who left Pennhurst for up to 14 years, and we really found out that they were much, much better off. Their lives just blossomed, and they flourished in these small little group homes in regular neighborhoods. So now we know that that is a beneficial thing, that people are better off, and all the other states in America, because of the lawsuit and the evidence, started doing the same thing. So we now have instead of 200,000 people in these institutions, we now have about 20,000. And we will probably live to see the end of them because we had the evidence. And that very same evidence is being told all over the world now. The United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities was placed in action in 2006, and since then 162 nations have signed it. And Article 19 of the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities says no one should grow up in or live their lives in a big segregated institution. And this all came from here. The knowledge, the experiment, if you will, of placing people out into small settings all over the community, the right to education and integrated education, and the right to treatment, another case that arose out of Pennhurst, this all really started here. And that's why some of my colleagues and I think that it's very worthy goal to set up an interpretive center and a museum at the old Pennhurst to tell this story that so few citizens know. It's a glorious story of American triumph out of the tragedy that was Pennhurst.
Yeah, and the longitudinal study really does provide the perspective. You know, some folks will say, how do we really know that these folks were taken care of equally or better outside of the institution? Well, this and other studies really do provide that perspective, not only from a care, but as you know, in your experience, one of the key challenges for moving individuals from state centers into the community is that fear of change. Right now, as we've said, we have five existing state centers, and the fear for change is probably one of the single most barriers to moving them out. As the ARC was instrumental in the closing of Pennhurst and those movements, we continue to try to educate families to see that their service, their support, and their development, no matter what the severity of their disability is, will be better outside in the community.
And that was a great learning experience in the 20th century.
Yeah. What can you give us just maybe an overview of the organization, kind of where you are? I know that you are taking this information, not housing it in a permanent site, I think as of yet, but moving it around to raise awareness. What's going on now?
We've produced a traveling exhibit, which has been at some of the major national conferences, and it's available. It's for schools, high schools, for volunteer groups, any place that would like to know about the history, this traveling exhibit is available. But more recently, one of the buildings at the old Pennhurst, the superintendent's mansion, has been turned over to our organization to try to raise funds and turn it into a place of dignity, a place of memory. Whereas what's going on with the old Pennhurst, the oldest buildings there were bought by a private investor, and they are putting on a Halloween haunted house and making a ton of money, but unfortunately some of it involves degrading imagery of people with disabilities, and we can't stand that. But making money at Halloween is fine, you know, more power to them, but please, no insults to the memory of the people who lived and died there.
And your website, where people might be able to take a look and support this worthy cause?
Yes, www.preservepennhurst.org. Easy to find. All the videos from the historical exposés are there. And our vision of an interpretive center. So we're going to need volunteers and expertise from engineering to architecture. I'm a scientist. I don't know what I'm doing here, but I know we've got to never forget. That I know.
Yes. Yes. well, Jim, thank you for being here with us. Half an hour goes really quick. I'd love to have you back again and kind of track the progression of this. We thank you for being with us here. And as we've said, this being March, Developmental Disability Awareness Month, we ask that you spread the word, that you tell your story or a story of a loved one to raise that awareness. Come to our website, thearcalliance.org. Join, like Jim has, our membership. and help us raise that awareness. Well, thank you for being with us, and have a great day.
For over 60 years, the ARC Alliance has been in your community, providing support and services for families and individuals with special needs. From birth through life, the ARC Alliance team of experts and specialists are here to find solutions to your needs.
For years, we felt alone as we take care of our son. The ARC Alliance support team brings compassion and understanding to our family and provides hands-on solutions.
The ARC Alliance, we're here to help you today. For more information, call 610-265-4700 or visit thearcalliance.org.